Praise the Lord, everyone. Glory to the Most High God. Thank God for the opportunity to be here, to be your speaker for this Wednesday night virtual Bible study. Hallelujah. Glory to the Most High God. I would like to first engage in a moment of prayer, and I also would encourage you at this moment, at this time, to, as you pray with me, ask God to speak to your heart tonight and meet whatever it is that you need from him. And I believe with you that he will answer your heart tonight and give it what you need tonight. Pray that prayer. Ask God to let you see him. Hallelujah. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, thank you first all for this very day, for my health and my strength. Oh God, the very breath I breathe, I give you the praise and the glory for it. Bless all of these that's in the sound of my voice across the airways, across this land. Oh God, wherever this word is being heard this night, God, that you be glorified, that they be edified. And I'm truly grateful. I bind every spirit that would even hinder, cause your word to have a free course in the midst. Use me, thy servant. Let nothing come forth out of my mouth except it be inspired of your Holy Spirit. And I give you all the praise and the glory and the honor in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I want to say good evening to all of you, all of our churches, all of the online visitors, or the online members. Greetings in the name of Jesus. I thank God for this opportunity, and I truly am grateful for some of the things I'll be talking about, some of the things Pastor Earl Jones spoke about. Give the Lord a hand clap for Pastor Earl for the great teachings that he did on Sunday. I can truly tell you he's a great teacher and a facilitator of the word, and he lives this word. He was one of my first teachers, along with Brother Bill Harris. Hallelujah. I thank God for them and for the foundation that he put in my life, that I'm still standing on it. And that foundation was Jesus. And I'm truly grateful to Pastor Earl Jones and all of my teachers, all of my fathers in the gospel, seeing their examples, these living examples. We have examples in the Bible, but I've been surrounded with witnesses, a cloud of witnesses that's living today. I thank God for Chief Apostle Wendell Archie. I've been following him for 42 and a half years. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ, and he's been following Jesus, and I'm following him. I've seen the sufferings and the afflictions, many things that he's gone through for the ministry that God gave him, and it always gives me hope to believe that I can endure and overcome. Seeing my fathers, I've seen all of the bishop. I was reminded today in prayer about Bishop Joseph Camuch and the 30 years that I spent with him. I wanted to give a shout out to him tonight publicly to let him know how much I love and appreciate and all what he put in me, the 30 years that I was under him in Lafayette. Pastor Jimmy Gilder was the first pastor that Chief Wendell Archer put over me. He taught and blessed me so much. When I went to Lafayette after 10 years, I thought I really had something, but I found out I was just beginning, just learning the ways of God after 10 years. But I can tell you what I really learned from Bishop Camuch. He would always say, God will never condemn a righteous man. I saw him go through many things. I saw people lie on him. I didn't see him get bent out of shape and reply the way they did him. And I watched his life. And that helped brought me a lot of mercy, long suffering, learning to be patient, pray and wait, pray and wait. However long it took, he always prayed and he waited and he trusted and believed in his leader. And that caused me to believe more in my leader Hallelujah. Because Bishop Joseph Kamuch always followed who God put over him. And that taught me discipline. And I'm grateful to him for that and what he's been in my life. I thank God for everyone that has contributed to me. I'm truly grateful. I want to be expounding or talking about some of the things that Pastor Earl Jones talked about Sunday about fathers in the gospel. And I want to say it's important to understand the role of a father. A father is a sustainer. He's a provider. He gives security to his family. He makes sure that they are taken care of and having whatever it is that they need naturally. I had people that taught me how to work and take care of my family. I saw them do it. And I started doing it. And I saw them go through many things. And when you're a father, you go through many things because it ain't about you, what you're going through. It's about your family. And you laying your life naturally down and taking many things in order to care for your family. And that's really, if you love them, you want to supply the things that they need. You know, Paul was beginning to speak in 1 Corinthians 4 and 15. He said, though you have many instructors, you don't have many fathers in this gospel. You don't have many fathers. Paul began to tell them about him being an apostle and how he felt like they were the last, the scum of the earth. He was warning people to become a father. You got to endure and go through something. I thank God for the 40 years, the 30 years under Bishop Joseph Kamuch. That helped prepare me for where I am today. And that's why I'm so grateful. I couldn't do this job except I went through training in Lafayette, Louisiana. You know, I mentioned on the last Bible study, I said, you know, I thank God for my wife is a virtuous woman. I thank God a woman that's virtuous, she might not get everything right, but when she see and know what's right, she's going to adapt to what's right. And we have to realize that we all are helpers one to another. And even though coming here at first, for the first like 2 years and something, but I can tell you here today, my wife's heart is not back in Lafayette. My wife's heart is here in Houston, Texas, and I see God had to do it. I couldn't do it. Nobody could do it, but I can say God did it. My wife have grabbed a hold of the ministry, and she's stepping out in faith, and her heart is here. She know where God want her. And I'm greatly and honored for her to be my wife of 55 years. That in itself is rare. In this country, only 7% make 50 years. And the over 50 is probably 5 or 6%. But I'm honored and thankful to God for the men of God teaching me how to be a father in the gospel. I knew naturally how to work and take care, but I didn't know how to truly love, honor, and look at my wife as a weaker vessel. And I know that my enemy today, your enemy today, is not your husband, it's not your wife, but it's the devil. Hallelujah. And God give you power. You the savior of the body. If the devil attack your house spiritually, you supposed to go pray attacking your wife, attacking your husband. That's not going to give you the victory. A house divided against itself, it won't stand. You know, people ask, why you always preaching on marriage? Because many marriages are in trouble. We are in a marriage, and if you're not obeying your husband, you're in trouble in your marriage, your spiritual marriage. You got to obey everything that he tells you. And you should obey everything your husband tells you if he's not telling you something to sin. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Paul warned you, everybody want to be great. To become great in God is to make yourself low, humble, and stay teachable. I'm still teachable. I'm a servant. I'm here to serve. When I finish serving, it's my time to sit down and wait and do whatever it is that I've been taught to do. I'm a helper with the father of this house, the prophet of this house, the apostle of this house. I'm here to help him with his people that he's put me among. And I thank God I'm honored for that opportunity. I want to go to the scriptures. I got some notes here. I want to talk about some of the things that Pastor Earl Jones talked about. And his title for the message Sunday was to stay in the fight. And I'm going to tell you tonight, in order to stay in the fight, you have to change your weapons. Because whatever you're doing, if you're not successful, you're using the wrong weapons. The number one weapon that you need to use is prayer. If you learn, like Bishop said, have a prayer life and don't just go pray. Because I have a quick little story to tell you about prayer tonight that happened in my home. Hallelujah. Glory to God. My wife and I went to Lafayette May the 31st, I think it was, to pick up my granddaughter, my great-granddaughter, rather. And I was supposed to pick up my granddaughter and my great-grandson, but he didn't make he failed. So he had to go 4 weeks to summer school. So we brought her alone, and she was going to be with us about 6 weeks. She was hurt because he couldn't come. But guess what? That morning before day, my granddaughter was in a closet praying and crying and got filled with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Of course, you know, when you hear that, you're a little reluctant when you feel with the Holy Spirit and you've been praying and hoping. And my granddaughter also got filled with the Holy Spirit. One that we've been praying and had sleepless night. I mean, I know if you just keep praying and keep believing and wait on the Lord, God will move, but don't never give up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We can sleep easier at night because I see the change in my granddaughter and my great-granddaughter's life. And from the time we picked her up over 3 weeks ago, her tongue ain't changed. She go and she pray and she cry out to God, and she use most of the time she's in the speaking in tongues. Hallelujah. And I see her life is changing. Her desires and attitude and her mind. 15 years old. I thank God for that. But this week, we knew we had to wait 4 weeks for her brother to finish his summer school. But how many know that God got a plan? Sometimes that can intercept our plan or our thoughts and what we thought it was going to be. Hallelujah. This week, we were talking about my grandson. My granddaughter called and said that my son, in 2 weeks, he completed what he needed to do in 4 weeks, and they promoted him to the next grade. So now we needed to get a way to get him down here to be with us. When we heard that, my granddaughter ran into her bedroom and started praying in the spirit. I got on the phone and I called Lafayette to see if anybody was coming this way that could bring my great-grandson down here. And when I got on the phone and called, I called Pastor Aaron, then I called another brother, and the brother knew what I wanted. He said, "I'll bring her. I'll bring him. I'll do it for you, Pastor." I say, "Thank you, Jesus." When my granddaughter came out of prayer and then came back in there, I say, "Your prayer was answered, Cody." I say, "Your brother will be here Saturday if it be the Lord's will." Hallelujah. I just thank God for prayer out of the mouth of babes and suckling. He have a perfect praise, perfected praise. Hallelujah. I just want to throw that in. It's so important to pray. God hear your cries, and he will move for you. We want to talk about, hallelujah, I want to go back to Ruth, and I do believe, man, that really blessed me so much. And I went back and reviewed the story and read it I don't know how many times over the years, but how many know that the longer you stay saved and the more you hear, I've heard Apostle Wendell Archer probably preach from this book 40 years ago. Hallelujah. But some of the things that I heard him preach, even about Ruth, I still retain it. And when it come back to my mind, I remember that he said that, and now I understand better why he said things that I didn't see. There are a lot of things in a lot of these books I didn't see. But God give you sight through knowledge when you humble yourself, when you pray, you fast, and you die out, and you allow him to convert you and put a new mind in you, a new spirit in you. But I want to try to take my time tonight, but I want to go tonight to the book of Ruth. And this book blessed me so much just reading back over it. And I want to even go to, because I want to say tonight, to me, it's like you could look at Naomi as a prodigal daughter. Hallelujah. I'm going to talk to you about her life and what she did. And sometimes a lot of people, she left home, left the country, left church. She went to a country that worshiped a whole bunch of different idol gods. But she went with her husband. Hallelujah. But how many know that her husband brought her? She went with him, but he died. His two sons died. And she was hurt and became bitter. But she did hear about that God was blessing at back home. So at least she had a mind after 10 years of her sons being married to her two daughters, and they died. I don't know how many years she'd been there, but it had been quite a while. But I want to go to Ruth. I want to go to the first chapter of Ruth, and I want to begin to expound on some things here, and I want you to I want to talk about when Naomi got ready to go back to her land and her two daughters was there, and she began to talk with them and let them know she had nothing else to offer them. That even if she would get married again and have a son, they didn't want to wait till they was of age to marry. So she let both of them know, you go back. They started off a little ways with her, but she said, look, you need to go back home. I'm going to let the Bible speak. Let's say again. Let's go to the Word of God, and I'm going to take my time because I really want you to put yourself, if you have left, backslid, or left away from the ministry, you can find hope in this book, in Ruth. You can find hope in this Word tonight and see what God will do for you, the same as he did for the prodigal son. When he came back, his father said he was dead, but now he's alive again, and he didn't wait for him to go on a fast or stay in church 6 months. He began to bless him the same day that he came back. How many know that the son that was there doing everything the father say was a little envious of the father giving favor to the one that returned, that had went out and wasted all of his substance? Backslid, didn't even live what he was taught anymore. Went out and joined up with a bunch of people. So here, Naomi was in Moab. And her sons married two Moab women. Hallelujah. But it's amazing that though her sons was married to these women, neither one of them had any children for them. God shut up Ruth's womb until he was ready for her. So God got a plan. Hallelujah. The gifts and calling of God is without repentance. Whatever God call you for, wherever you are, if you're in the sound of my voice, you need to return back home, because nobody feels and thinks about you like you think we feel. We are full of love, the same love that we had for you when you was here before. We're going to show you that love and more to try to help you back, because some of you may be bitter. Now, let me tell you something. Naomi was bitter. And she didn't feel that God had been, she looked at the afflictions from God. I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but I want you to understand tonight, if you can get your hope and get back to your, get back home, get back where God started you off at, it doesn't matter where you are. You got to know in your own heart and your own mind, ain't no place like home where God placed me here, and this is my home. Hallelujah. Houston 9 is my home. Slidell was my home. I'm a wayfaring man. Lafayette became my home. I had to forget about Slidell. And when my wife didn't want to go to Slidell, out of Slidell to Lafayette. But when we got ready to move Lafayette, she was so comfortable there, I couldn't bring her back to Slidell talking about living. She understood her purpose for God. She loved and adapted Lafayette so much in her heart, it was hard to let it go more than her nativity, where she was born at. Hallelujah. But God can do it through prayer and your patience. You can't make no grown woman or grown man do anything. You have to pray and ask, let God do it. Hallelujah. God can do what you can't do. All things is possible to them that believe, but you have to pray and wait on him to do it. Look what happened here. She told him, the 12th verse, turn again, my daughters, go your way. I'm too old. Go to the 14th verse. Now, they lift up their voice and wept again. They had already wept when they knew she was leaving and going. But how many know every time somebody weeping, it ain't love or sincerity? Oh, yeah, but they both cried. They both wept. And they both loved her and kissed on her much. But let me show you something here. And she said, okay. And Oprah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. You know, the kiss might have been sincere, but Ruth's love had action. Love is an action word. You know, everybody say, I love you, but if you don't ever show it when I need you, how do I know you love me? Anybody can say I love you, but love works no ill. Love is something that'll help. Love is always. Charity will suffer long. It don't matter how long it take you to get it. I didn't get it overnight. It took years for me to get it. And I'm still a student. I'm still willing to be taught after 42 and a half years. But look what happened. And she said, behold, thy 15, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. They had more than one. They had a bunch of gods over there. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee. You know, though Naomi was out of the will of God in Moab, but one thing about it, wherever you've been exposed to the truth and righteousness, it's going to be something that people still going to see on you, though you done backed up and still some. See, Ruth saw something in Naomi for the years that she was her mother. Hallelujah. She treated her like her daughter. She loved her. Uh-oh, mother-in-law. You got to love your mother-in-law. That's your mother by law. Hallelujah. You're supposed to love her like you let your mother by. So you ought to let your mother-in-law by. Don't be I don't know how God got me on this. Some people can't get along with their mother-in-law because they always compare the mother-in-law with their mama. Your mom ain't all of that. Yeah, you're supposed to love and honor her, but don't be a respect of person. That's your mother by marriage and your father by marriage. And you should honor them also. Might not get as many amens as I want on that, but God said in his word to love your mother and your father, that your days be long upon this land. You got to love your mother and fathers in the gospel. Hallelujah. Pastor Benoit was preaching. He say, get with the elders. Hey, do you know what? If you're a good follower, you will become a good leader. Hallelujah. Glory to the Most High God. But look what Ruth said. Entreat me not to leave thee or return from following after thee. And whether thou goest, I will go. I don't care if you ain't get a husband over there. I ain't worried about that. It's you I love and I want to be with. And where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people. And my God, and thy God, my God. Where thou diest, will I die. And there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. That was dedicated. That's love, ain't it? When she saw that she was steadfastly minded to go with her, then she left speaking unto her. Hallelujah. Now, they went in, so they too went until they came to Bethlehem, and it came to pass when they were come to Bethlehem that all the city was moved about them. And they said, is this Naomi? They was glad to see her. Hallelujah. Glad that she was back home. And she said unto them, call me not Naomi. Call me Mara. Naomi means beautiful. Naomi, you know, in the Bible, they gave names according to character that fit people. So Naomi didn't deserve, think she deserved, because she, this is why. For the Almighty had dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord had brought me home again empty. But how many know it don't matter if you ain't got a lot to come back home with you? You gonna get everything you need, because the just shall live by faith and not sight. Hallelujah. And then, call ye me Naomi, seeing the Lord had testified against me, and the Almighty had afflicted me. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God will deliver them out of them all. You gotta trust and believe. So Naomi returned, and Ruth, the Moabite, is her daughter-in-law with her, which returned out of the country of Moab. One thing that I wanted to show you that's so important, even as Pastor Earl was bringing this message out, is something how Naomi, I'm not going to go through all of it. You know, Naomi came back, though she was bitter, but she got back in church among some of her peers. How many know that when other people are around you and you can forget about your sorrow and you see you got help and somebody praying with you, praying for you and trying to help you get reestablished? She did have land there, but probably not much help, but somebody helped. How many know what I mean? And then not only that, Ruth, she wanted to go to work. She was a single woman now. She wasn't worried about a man. She wanted to go to work. And I mean to know that God, when you make your mind up, and it was by faith that she was going to leave mama, father's, for the gospel's sake, for the truth. Hallelujah. God had a plan for her. But she was a woman that had some class and respect for herself. She went out there and started working, and God led her right to the right field, which was of her kin's. God did it, and God can lead you if you allow him to. God got it the end figured out before, at the beginning. God already know everything. So you just have to trust him. But look what happened. She wasn't worried about a husband. She didn't go get with the men. She didn't get among the brothers. She went by the maids and started working. And then when guess what? When Boab, you know, people think that Boab just saw she a beautiful woman. He realized that she was a Moabitess. He was kinfolk to Naomi's husband. So Naomi told him all about this woman and what happened. So it's good that you don't have to always tell, let another speak well of you. She didn't have to go over there and tell all of them in the field what she did and why she came. No, her mother-in-law told it. And guess what? Boaz heard it and took note of it. But Naomi did not know that that's where she's going to wind up, in his field. But when she wind up in his field, he saw something different. How she conducted herself. Hallelujah. Glory to God. She didn't have, you know, gleaming, you got to pick it up off the ground. And if her dress would have been too short, when she been over and the men working over there, y'all want me to stop? No. If her dress was too short, when she been over, she'd have been showing something she shouldn't have been showing. So it's important to know your dress should be appropriate for whatever the situation is. No, we don't say it's got to be below the knees. But if it's at the knees and you sit down and you study pulling and you're showing too much, it's too short. You can't stretch the material. Okay, let me go on here. Hallelujah. So he took notice and he commanded them young brothers to stay away from her. He was watching out for the women. That's what we as men of God do. We don't allow the women, the single women, to come in here and become a prey. And we don't allow the baby, the young brothers to come in here to be a prey. We are watchmen. We are watching out for your soul. And we're going to point out danger. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You need some counsel. You need somebody showing you what the dangers is. The Bible says if a man desire a wife, he desire a good thing. It didn't tell the wife, if you desire a husband, it's a good thing to go after him. No, the man's supposed to take the lead in that. And he should be drawn from the way you carry yourself the same way Ruth was drawn to Boaz. And Boaz wasn't a young man based on how he ascribed to them young men that was working for him. He had plenty of opportunity to get married. He was wealthy. But how many know that God was saving Boaz for Ruth? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know it ain't too many in here to clap. I know I'm online. I'm getting some amens. Hallelujah. Because some people have the can't help it. Jacob waited 7 years for the woman that he loved. He got the other daughter. Hallelujah. And he had to work 7 more years for Rachel. But if it's love, nobody else came and beat him out with Rachel. You don't have to be in a rat race for a wife or a husband. If they for you, they'll keep. You want to marry next week. You ain't even got nowhere to hardly live. How you going to be a father if a baby come? You got trouble taking care of yourself right now. But you won't have to stay in that condition. And this is not necessary for everybody. Some people may be prepared and ready. And when you are, the preacher going to say yes. Marry whom you will. Only in the Lord. Don't bring somebody off your job and think the preacher going to okay them. He don't know nothing about them. And we don't know much about somebody been here a year or two. Ain't too much fire been on. Ain't too much trouble came their way. How do we know how he's going to treat you? We don't. It takes time. Hallelujah. We are not against marriage. Marriage is honorable in all. Whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. If you got one, you still a whoremonger. You can't justify it. It doesn't matter. Go marry her if you love her. Hallelujah. Give her her paper. You put a tag on your car and register it. Go register if you say you love her. And if you listening, young lady, you ought to demand it. Leave him till he make his mind up to marry you. Hallelujah. Because once you come and get saved, and he ain't saved, we ain't going to say amen unless it's certain circumstances like our chief have allowed things when there were children involved. He's allowed it. Hallelujah. Let me get away from that. Hallelujah. I don't want to stay too long. I got a few others I want to teach you about how to fight. Hallelujah. But I want to show you what happened after she went gleaning. And boy, I've noticed her and began to tell her only to gleam in his field and gave her favor. And when it came time for the courtship, you know, Boaz went through the process. He had to go take his shoe off, and he had to go to the next of kin. There was somebody that was ahead of him, a closer kin than he was. And he had to first go to him and see that if he wanted to redeem and buy the land from Naomi, what her husband had, and take up his wife, take up Ruth. But the next of kin didn't, so Boaz said that he would. So I want to show you the results of it in the fourth chapter, because I don't want to spend a lot of time, but I want you to see. Though Naomi was bitter, though she was afflicted, and many other afflictions of the righteous, but God will deliver you out of them all, but it ain't always be overnight. It ain't going to be a week. It ain't always be 6 months. And if lust is driving you to want to marry and you ain't got no preparations for it, it's going to fail. We against divorce. Seen too many went in it. Even if you do everything right, you still going to have trouble blending and making two minds into one. I'm still working on it sometimes. After 40, almost 3 years here, I have to still make adjustments. I have to still deal with challenges in my marriage. But I want to do it the godly way, regardless if I'm the leader, I'm in charge. I want to be kind. If I thought I said something wrong, I go and say I'm sorry. That's why it's important to pray every day. Some people too proud to say I'm sorry because they think the other person was a little more at fault. It doesn't matter to me. I could be 10%. She could be 90%. I'll take the 10% and say, hey, I'm sorry. I could have did my 10% better. Hallelujah. Glory to the Most High God. I'm going to show you what happened. Boaz, you know, Naomi went to the threshing floor where Boaz was. Boaz didn't touch her. She slept there all night. And because of this man's respect, he retained her integrity. He said, don't even let anybody know that she came into this threshing floor. Hallelujah. Because that's who he wanted to marry. And he didn't want everybody around saying he already slept with her because he knew. But I tell you one thing, don't you make no provision. Don't you go nowhere that you shouldn't with your husband or your wife to be before it's time. When you sign that paper, then you can go any, you can take about anywhere where it's right to go. But just don't make no provision trusting in your flesh. It will let you down. You can't take fire in your bosom and not be burned. But look what God did. Naomi didn't mind responding to the name Naomi after God. She saw what God began to do for her. Look. Because when he did it for Ruth, he did it for her. If one is blessed, we all blessed. We all should have the same care one for the other. When we see somebody that's in need and shut up our bowels of compassion, we should always help. God always cared about the poor down through the years. Always have cared about the poor. And we should care about the poor. First of all, tell the poor, If they ain't working, they ain't gonna eat. I'm gonna give you a meal today, but you go get a job. If you sleep to 9 or 10 o'clock and come back over here for the barbecue and you ain't got a job, I might say, wait a minute, you need to go look for a job. I don't want you to get thinking that somebody else that is working is supposed to take care of you. You can get into covetousness and then using the scripture out of contact. You're supposed to help me. No, we want to help people that's willing to help themselves. So Boaz took Ruth, and she was his wife. And when he went in unto her, the Lord gave her conception. She bare a son. Guess what? Even though Boaz is going to take care of it, this son belonged to her son. Hallelujah. This first male was going to be the seed of the dead. Let me show you. And the women said unto Naomi, blessed be the Lord, which had not left thee this day without a kinsman, that his name may be famous in Israel, and he shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life. How many know God can restore what the cankerworm ate, what the palmer worm ate? I say God can restore it. But if you can get down here and howl on this altar and be persistent in your prayer and wait patiently, you got to endure hardness and be a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You got to arm yourself with the same mind that Jesus had. If you suffer in your flesh, you will cease from sin. If you ain't suffered much, you ain't got rid of much. You want to reign with him, be great. If you don't suffer, pray, fast, and put on the Lord Jesus Christ, you ain't gonna have what you think you got. Everybody wanna know him in the power of the resurrection. But get to know him in the fellowship of the sufferings. Hallelujah. He suffered. He suffered. Look what happened here. He shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life. You're going to bring joy back and a nourisher of thine old age. Don't you tell me God can't bless you in your old age. He can bless you through your offspring. Can you say amen? For thy daughter-in-law, which loved thee, which is better to thee than seven sons, had borne him. And Naomi took the child and laid it in her bosom and became nurse unto it. And the women, her neighbors, gave it a name, saying, this is a son born to Naomi. And they called his name Obed. He is the father of Jesse, the father of David. He became famous with a woman that wasn't even us of Israel, and she got her own book in the Bible. And she didn't have nothing to do with it. God did it. But she did have something to do with it. She loved her mother-in-law and saw something different about her than she did the people that she grew up with. Give the Lord a hand clap. Pastor Earl say, stay in the fight. Huh? Keep doing good. God gonna reward you. Sometime the last gonna be first, and the first be last, but just wait in there. Just wait. Wait. Just wait on him. Some 30, some 60, some 100. It ain't given to the swift or the battle to the strong. This is an endurance race. Hallelujah. You gotta endure this thing till the end. Hallelujah. When an unrighteous man turn away from all of his evil and sin and unrighteousness and turn and do that which is right, that same day God forgot all of that he did. And a righteous man, you could live righteous 40 years and you turn away from the righteousness that been keeping you and turn to start doing evil, all of the righteousness that you ever did is not going to be remembered. Hallelujah. Don't matter if you cast devils out at one time. It don't matter what you did, many wonderful work. But he going to say, get away from me. I never knew you. This is straight and a narrow. And the Bible say, make straight path for your feet. Least that which is lame be turned out of the way. This oppressed, the kingdom of heaven suffer violence. But the violent, you take it by force. Hallelujah. You got to take it. Don't say the devil took it. The devil can't take nothing from you if you relying on God. He give you power. Acts 1:8. If you got the Holy Ghost, if he ain't, you got it. You'll get some power that you can have confidence. The devil's a bluff. The devil can come at you, but God will keep you in the midst. You resist him, he'll flee. You got to resist him. He come to your mind and tell you all the pleasures of your life in your past. As soon as you go on the fast, he remind you of everything. Hallelujah. But you got to cast that down. Cast down every imagination. Let's go to 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, chapter 10. I'm going to show you how to fight. If you don't have the weapons, get them. It's all done through the Spirit of the living God. A lot of folks say we got gifts and grandma had a gift. If grandma didn't have the Holy Spirit, she didn't have no gift from God. Because all of God's gifts come inside the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's what my Bible tells me. Now you can believe what you want. Hallelujah. But this is, the Bible says, study to show yourself approved. A workman that need not be made ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You got to get in this Bible and start studying it. And get it down in your heart. Look what he say here, the third verse. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Romans 8 and said the carnal mind is enmity against God. It ain't subject to the law of God, neither indeed can it be. So when you hear from God, if you're a priest, you hear from God and you speak to the people, you better find it in this Bible. If it ain't in this Bible, you might not have got it from God. Because we all only can be one through this same word. Speak the same thing. Live holy. Hallelujah. We got to be holy in all manner of conversation because your conversation is what's teaching somebody. We should always be edifying. Some people just want to live in pleasure. They want the basketball. They want the fishing. They don't want the burden of praying and sanctifying and fasting and being away from each other sometime. I know we're in a pandemic, but I'm going to show you. God is a keeper. Hallelujah. When the children of Israel struggled, they got stronger. We're in a struggling time. The world might get weaker, but get your eyes off of the world. Get your eyes off of pleasure. He that liveth in pleasure, you dead while you live it. Because you so much into the world, you love it so much, you can't leave it. Hallelujah. If you love the world, the love of God is just not in you. You can't love two. And whoever you spend the most of your time, whatever's in your heart, that's what you'll do. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There's nothing wrong with a vacation now and then, but you shouldn't live a vacation. You shouldn't live on the fish creek or live at the domino table. Hallelujah. You should discipline yourself. Again, the fourth verse. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imagination and every high thing that exalt itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedient when your obedience is fulfilled. Get the desire out of you. Desire. Your desire, if it's contrary for your desire for God, is sin. Your desires will take you away from God. This Bible gonna bring you closer to God. Look what the Bible say here. Once you get the beam out of your eye, the Bible say that beam is blocking your view. And the only thing blind you is sin. Sin will blind you and having you think you right when you're wrong. Hallelujah. Once you get the beam out, you can see clearly. You're doing the same thing Romans says in the third chapter, I believe. You're going to tell somebody else not to steal and you steal. You're going to tell them not to commit sacrilege and you doing it. You got other gods you're going after. So make sure that you living what you preaching or what you teaching. Or not quoting it because you heard a preacher saw it and think you're going to get the same effect. It's the anointing that break the yokes. God will anoint you when you seek him, when you fast and you pray. And he'll cause you to be a deliverer in Israel. You can deliver your friend when you stop patting and going along with her. You can deliver your children when you pull a belt out and do what the Bible say. You can talk until you red or you blue or you black. That ain't going to every time deliver them. Fooling is bound in the heart. And he didn't say you talk to them 7 days, 3 hours a day. No. He said beat them. Oh no, many folks think, oh no, I've been in school. And they say use time out. And they say if I beat them, I'm going to make them violent. So you're going to let them be true or let God? They're going to become your God? Or you going to let God be God? You think God, they know more about God's, what he invented, what he created? The creature know more than the creator? No, sir. I'm going to believe what God said. Yeah, there's a limited. And there's a level, but you wait till they get 18, you're going to have a fight. Oh, you're going to get mad and want to jump on them. When if you train them up in the way that it should go and make sure they got a fear of you. He ain't got no fear of you. He 5 years old and you tell him he go do the same thing 5 minutes later. And when you at my house, you say, I'm going to get you when we get home. Stop lying to little Johnny. Don't lie to your children. I'm going to get you. No, that's pride. You trying to make me believe or somebody else believe that he don't behave that way at your house. Yeah, he do flips on your stuff like he's doing on mine. People don't like this kind of preaching, but this is Bible. This is the Bible. Hallelujah. Glory to the Most High God. Let's go now to Deuteronomy 28. I'm going to stay there a little bit. And then I'm going to go to Exodus. I don't want to be long before you. When God finish, I want to be finished. Even if it ain't 8:30. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm going to start at the first verse, and I'm going to skip a little, but I want you to know that when God is talking to his people, it's certain conditions, standards, and things that you have to meet. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, not occasionally, diligently, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come on thee, overtake thee, if thou shall hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. And when you go in the field and you get a job and they say your eyes brown, don't quit. You want a family, you got to practice this before you get a wife, because they dependent on you. When the light's about to be cut off, you're going to want the brother to pay it. No, stay on your job. I suffered many things on my job of 19 years. Hallelujah. Pray. God will get rid of the boss before he wants you to leave. You be holy and righteous. The king's heart is in the hand of God. He can turn it whatsoever way he will. I've known many. About the big boss, one of the owners on my job, he came against me. I just prayed and cried. I didn't pray for God to get rid of him. But it wasn't long after he did it. I still respect him and did what was right. I knew the way he talked to me was wrong, but he said, bless them that curse you. Pray for those that spitefully use you. Do good to people that hate you. Now, you're going to tell me you can love your enemy and you can't love your wife or your brother. Don't you get quiet on me. I ain't got a bunch of folks in here, but I don't want you drawing up at home. Look what it says here. For blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, and the increase of thy kine, and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store. Blessed shall thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shall thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come against thee one way, and shall flee before thee seven ways. And this is what God is saying that'll happen. But now I want you to go to the 13th verse, where the 12th verse. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure, the heaven, to give the rain unto thy land in his season, and to bless all the work of thine hand. And thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. And the Lord shall make thee the head and not the tail. And thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath. If that thou hearken unto the commandments of the Lord thy God, which I command thee this day, to observe and to do them. And if you go aside, what do you say? If thou shalt go aside from any of the words which I command thee this day, to the right hand or to the left, or to go after other gods to serve them. And then all of these, the rest of these verses is all a cursings that's going to be against you. If you want God to be with you, you have to be with him. If you draw nigh to God, God will draw nigh to you. He said it. Hallelujah. And if you find that you contrary to this word, you can repent wherever you are, not justify yourself and blame somebody else for what and why you did what you did. The Bible says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Preacher can't work it out for you. I can tell you what's right. I can't work out Marie's. I can tell her what's right. I can pray for her, but she still got to work it out. You got to work out your soul salvation with fear and trembling. Can't blame somebody else. You hear the children of Israel, all of them came out of Egypt together. But with many of them, God wasn't well pleased. They all drank that spiritual drink. And that rock followed them, which is Christ. But you can be right here in the house of power. Pastor Barry over there in Lake Charles, you can be in the house of power and you still could have no power. And don't blame nobody else. Because you have to humble yourself before the mighty hand of God for him to exalt you. Humility comes before honor. Humble yourself. Hallelujah. Go with me to Exodus chapter 14. I know it's kind of hard to turn the pages if you got a Bible or even use your phone, so I'll give you a minute, but now give the Lord a hand clap. We ain't got many here, but I got two clapping for this word. Thank you. Thank you for those that are clapping. To God be the glory. Exodus chapter 14. I'm going to start reading at verse 13. Now this is where Moses had brought the children of Israel out, and they was at the Red Sea, and they began to chide against Moses, and they began to say all kind of things. Pharaoh's army was right behind them. You know, God put a fire between them and decided that on their side it was black, dark. On the children of Israel's side, it was light. Don't we serve a mighty God? It was dark over there on all of the 1,600. I forgot how many. I read it even today. But Pharaoh and all of his army was behind the children of Israel, had them hemmed up. And I guess they was thinking for sure, we got them now. The mountains on both sides, the Red Sea in front of them. But God gonna always make a way. But what if some straggled back and didn't stay with it? The army would have overtook them. So it's important to know that follow the leader. The things that we're experiencing here in this land, the political issues and the things that you see that's troubling, the militias that's growing, and the people that still 40% of the 300 million, they still love the liar. And if the Bible speaks, if a ruler hearken to lies, all of them that follow him are wicked. We saw his daughter try to take the high road like she believed in what the attorney general said, but we find out she said something else when no camera was on her. But she didn't think she was going to be contradicted. Oh, yes, but she was. You have to pray for this country, because a lot of these things that God is bringing up on this land, he said, when you see these signs, you know that the end is nigh. War against war, Ukraine, you see what Russia is doing. Pray for the leaders. Pray for your leader. Pray for Joe Biden. I believe his heart is in the best interest. Yeah, there are ungodly people, Republicans and Democrats, but down through the history, the Democrats always looked out for the poor. So I believe God would rather favor them than the Republicans. Check your history. I've been around here, be 80 years next month. I lived it. I still see it. You can't legislate love, but you can be a light. Don't you hate because somebody else hate. Don't you revile when you revile. Husband, wife, or whoever. Co-worker, boss man. Humble yourself. Show you what God will do. The 13th verse. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, you shall see them again no more forever. Think about your little situation. The Lord shall fight for you and you shall hold your peace, husband. Hold your peace, wife. Hold your peace, brother. Listen to your elder. Listen. Don't grieve the one that's watching over your soul. Hallelujah. Hold your peace. All right, one more. Second Chronicles, chapter 20. Teach you how to fight. Sometimes holding your peace and casting your care upon God, doing what 1 Thessalonians say. If you're suffering and going through in the church, God is molding you. Learn to rejoice in tribulation. Don't be sad and mad every time God take you through something. Hallelujah. God will recompense. But when he does, you ought to feel bad if you holy when you see your enemy. If God get them, you ought to say, oh, still be tremble and not, I know God was going to get you. I'm a child of God. You ain't a child of nothing when you're talking like that. God allowed what happened to come. Blame God for the trial. Didn't Jesus tell you that? You say, I'm going to join air, equal air with Christ. He know the hair on your head, but he don't know what you're dealing with. He knows everything about you. Nothing is hidden from him. But look what he says here. Second Chronicles, chapter 20. And I'm going to start reading at the 20th. At the 13th verse. In the wrong one, be patient with me. I'm excited. Hallelujah. My wife always telling me to be patient and take your time. Sometimes it's hard for me, but I'm going to work on it. Hallelujah. Now, here was the children of Moab and Ammonites, two nations, come against Jehoshaphat to battle. That's the first verse, but I want to show you, Jehoshaphat prayed. He sought God. And I want to read one verse here in the night, 20 and 9. If when evil come upon us as the sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine, we stand before this house and in thy presence, for thy name is in this house, and cry unto thee in our affliction, then thou wilt hear and help. He began to tell him what they were facing. Many of you are facing something. We all go through afflictions, something about every day. So now look what he said, do. The 13th verse. And all Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. Then upon Jahaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jeiel, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. And he said, hearken ye all Judah, and inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou, King Jehoshaphat, thus said the Lord unto you, be not afraid, nor dismayed by the reason of this great multitude, For the battle is not yours, but God's. I'm finished. Clap your hands for Jesus. Don't worry about the famine. God got a way, can make a way. God will bless you with a job. You seek after it. Seek after him. Knock and the door be open unto you. Everybody that knock will receive. But walk humbly before the God, before our God, giving thanks and praise for everything. Bless him at all times, like psalmists say. You know the poor man cried and God delivered him out of all of his trouble. Hallelujah. And his hand is not shortened that he can't save. Only your sin separate between you and your God. Repent. Turn away. He'll pardon you. He'll forgive you. Give the Lord a hand clap. At this time, I'd like for you to give me the messages for the week. Monday through Friday at 100.7 FM KKHT, the Word, from 5 a.m. to 5:30 a.m., from 9:30 a.m. to 10 a.m., from 8:30 p.m. to 9 p.m. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Wednesday, weekly services. Wednesday, 7 p.m. It'll be virtual until otherwise. Youth and young adult meeting, 7 p.m. online. Sunday, new members class online at 8:50 a.m. Sunday school at 9 a.m. online. Morning service, 10 a.m. streamed. Night service, 7 p.m. online. I think we got one more for the Monroe. Okay, if you want to give, making generosity simple. Go to Push Pay. Text RTMINC to 77977. If you're old and ain't technically advanced, like I'm not in a lot of stuff, call. Somebody will help you. Call the church and somebody. Don't say that you want to give and can't. We'll make a way for you to give. It's more blessed to give than to receive. When you give, God will give back unto you. God will do it. He said it. He's not a man should lie, not a son of man that he should repent. Why don't you try it? You can't outgive him. So give. And we also have a land that you pledge to for Monroe, the 4 acres on US 165. Continue until you pay your pledge out. It's better not to have vowed and not to fulfill what you vowed. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That concludes. I want to close out with a prayer for all of you and take a moment of prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Oh God, you said your word wouldn't go out void. Oh God, move for all of these. Oh God, that heard your word, God. Break the yoke, bring deliverance, God. Keep them for your great name's sake. Raise them up, God. Strengthen them. Oh God, you said let the weak say they strong and they trusting and trusting and believing you to fight the battle. Oh God, help us to cast all our care upon you. We know you care for us. Move for all of these, oh God. Draw them to thee, oh Lord, through some of our lives, oh God, that you be glorified in them. Save, break yokes, bring healing, God, bring deliverance. God, heal those, oh God, that are even listening online. God, bring healing, oh God, to whatever it is, physical and spiritual. I command that every yoke be broke. God, that you be glorified. Free him, Jesus. In Jesus' name, I pray. You dismiss. God bless you.